Chair will now call Kathleen Averett, representing herself, testifying against the bill.
Good evening.
Good evening. My name is Kathleen Averett. I'm here today to state my opposition to House Bill 60. I'm a constituent of Representative Eddie Rodriguez here in Austin, and I'm also a hold a Master of Divinity degree from Harvard University from 2008. I'm here representing myself. I just wanted to state that I oppose this legislation because I agree with the experts who have stated that regulations like those that HB 60 would require do not support women's health, and in fact that they're bad for women's health policy, and that the bill would place onerous requirements on health centers that provide safe and perfectly legal abortions, and that it does nothing to improve the health and safety of women. I'm concerned that this bill would particularly increase the burden on women who don't live in the major cities in Texas, who would have much further to travel and have to take much more time off of work, and it would just be a much bigger financial burden to travel to these major cities, and it would not add anything to their experience. It would not improve their health or their safety. It would have no positive effect on these women's health, and it's not medically necessary. I had an older family friend say to me once that women my age don't have any idea what it was like before Roe v. Wade. That we just can't conceptualize it, and I think that she was right. And I think that I would ask you to keep it that way. I think that I don't want to know what it's like to personally or to have my friends, family, loved ones experience having an unwanted pregnancy or a wanted pregnancy that for some reason they feel they can't carry to term, and to feel that they do not have any options or that the options are prohibitively expensive or just downright dangerous. I don't want to know what it's like to lose a friend to an unsafe abortion procedure, and I don't think, given that the Constitution protects this legal procedure, that women my age should know what it was like to live in the time before Roe v. Wade. I've been here since 1 o'clock this afternoon because I wanted to make sure that I could give my testimony to you. I think this is an incredibly important issue for me, for my family, and for all Texas women. And so I thank you for this time, and just urge you to oppose this bill. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Any questions?
Mr. Chairman, no questions for Elizabeth. Mr. Chairman, would you announce to the folks in the overflow room that you'll allow them time, you'll call their name and allow them time? Because yes, I think I've gotten some messages that there's some confusion. And,
yes,
okay, thank you.
Yes. Yeah, just to be clear, Representative Farrar has asked that if somebody's in the overflow room, if we call you and you don't come up right away, we'll make sure that you come and talk to the clerk, and we'll call you up as the next witness. Thank you. I'm sorry, sir. I'm sorry, I can't have you testify from the audience like that. I understand. We are letting the people know in advance.
Maybe
and we'll make another announcement. Yes, ma'am. I understand. John Abramowitz. I'm sorry if I screwed your name up. I apologize. Representing yourself, testifying against the bill. Again, if you're in the overflow room, please come up, but we're showing him not testifying and against the bill. Next witness. Susan Albers, representing herself, testifying against the bill.
Good evening. My name is Susan Albers. I'm here representing myself and my daughter in firm opposition to this bill. I'd like to just follow up on a discussion that was had earlier with the OBGYN, who was talking about if we do close these facilities that people will go online, YouTube or whatnot, and figure out how to do it on their own. I conducted a little experiment before I came. I Googled RU486 and online pharmacies, and I got 409,000 results. So I picked one of them and went through the process and found, I did everything short of putting my MasterCard number in, but I found that for 90 euros that I could get delivered to my door, postage included, a full abortion kit. So I think we have to ask ourselves, is this bill really going to accomplish what we say it should accomplish? And if we pull the rug out from under these facilities, is it not very likely that these online pharmacies are going to become very attractive to desperate people? And what then? Will these women have any medical care at all? They won't have any screening. They won't have any backup. If they do begin to bleed after self-help and are lucky enough to make it to an emergency room, will they be reluctant to talk about what pill they took? So I think that this bill is short-sighted. I think that it's irresponsible, and I think that it's mean-spirited, and I encourage you to vote against it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Is there any question? No? Thank you. Chair will now call John Abramowitz again, representing himself, testifying against the bill. I apologize if I screwed your name up there, John.
Nobody can say it or spell it.
Okay.
Quite all right.
Well, I couldn't say it, and I'm pretty sure I can't spell it. So.
Yeah. My name is John Abramowitz. When I can find work, I'm an attorney. So if I accidentally call any of you Your Honor as opposed to representative or Mr. or Madam Legislator, I apologize. And I'm here testifying. First of all, I'm represented by Elliot Neistat, Representative Neistat, and also I believe Senator Watson, unless something's changed. And I'm here testifying in opposition to HB 60. And I'm going to keep my remarks very brief and limited specifically to the bill's impact on me. And the initial reaction, I'm sure, is, well, what impact on you? Because, spoiler alert, I've never had an abortion. And I don't think it's very likely that I'm ever going to need one. But the only thing I know about economics, and it really is the only thing, is a thing called opportunity cost. And that means that the time, money, energy, effort that you spend doing one thing is time, money, energy, effort that you can't spend doing another thing. And I mentioned earlier that I'm an attorney when I can find work, which is not, frankly, all that often. I have a couple of lawyers that I work for who give me all the work they can, but their practices are strained too. And so what I'd like to know is why we're spending time doing this instead of taking action to create more jobs for myself and other millennials like me who, as I'm sure you know from the newspapers, have a much higher unemployment rate than the general average. I've heard a lot of talk here about pain, and I would like to know why it is that the pain, if in fact that's true, there's scientific evidence to the contrary, of somebody who isn't born yet is more important than the pain I feel when I have to ask my parents to help me pay the rent some months, and know that I'm preventing them from retiring as soon as they, or my father from retiring as soon as he might otherwise, or when I have to tell my girlfriend's mother that, no, I'm not in a position to marry her yet because I can't afford to. As a 30-year-old man in the prime of his life, that's a very embarrassing and painful set of circumstances for me to be in, and I'm having the prime of my life stolen from me, and I feel like, frankly, the people in power in this state don't care. And I want to know why this bill, which would actually not be pro-life at all, as others have pointed out, deserves a special session of this body, while the position that myself and so many other millennials are in does not. And that's all.
Thank you, sir. Any questions? No? Chair will now call Laura Allen, representing herself, testifying against the bill. You're not Laura. Okay. Laura Allen? We're going to show Ms. Allen not testifying, but her position is against the bill. The next chair will call Stephen Arcieri, representing himself, testifying against the bill. Is Stephen here? Let's show him not testifying. A-R-C-E-R-I. Okay. Show him testifying, not testifying, but against the bill. Okay. Are you Stephen? Okay. Good evening.
Thanks. I prepared a statement.
Okay.
I'll try to make it fast.
Great. We can't smell your breath.
I just ran from the other room, so excuse me. Thank you, Chair and Committee, for hearing my testimony today. My name is Stephen Arcieri, and I'm a constituent of Representative Elliot Neustadt, Vice Chair of the Public Health Committee. I'm a 20-year resident of Austin, a civic-minded registered voter of sound mind and good moral character, and I'm here to testify against these bills. Because I have a mother, stepmother.
Sir, Stephen.
Can you hear me?
Well, yeah, I can, but let's just talk about HB 60 right now.
Oh, right, sure. Yeah, I'm here to register my opposition to HB 60. But I'm here because I have a mother, a stepmother, two aunts, a godmother, three sisters, two sisters-in-law, two stepsisters, six nieces, two great-nieces, and many dear friends and colleagues who are women. I'm here to demand that all families in Texas have access to women's clinics within their own communities and not 20, 50, or 100 miles away, because women's clinics exist to meet the persistent growing need for basic care all over Texas, especially of women and families marginalized in an industrial health system driven by profit and is designed to control women's bodies on the part of doctors, scientists, and politicians who are mostly men. The women served by the clinics that are threatened with closure by HB 60 are not, as some ideologues fantasize, a faceless horde of welfare recipients, illegal immigrants, sex workers, and pregnant teenagers. In fact, these women are your own neighbors and associates, the people you see in your everyday life. Of the women you know, how many do you think have ever visited a women's clinic? How many women's clinics are there operating in your city or county per capita? Considering the strained funding for these clinics, how could they exist at all if there was no need for them? Due to the deplorable lack of basic care for women and their families under the industrial health system, community-based women's clinics remain the only safe, accessible, and affordable option for basic reproductive care to the growing number of poor and or uninsured women in Texas. Women's clinics provide vital services such as tests, examinations, prescriptions, referrals, procedures, contraception, counseling, and support, services which must be provided on a consistent basis in order to maintain the public standard of health provided for in Chapter 31 of the Texas Health and Safety Code, and thus to preserve life, which is in the interest of the state. But life is not merely defined by its beginning and end, but also by its quality throughout its duration. Abortion must remain legal in all 50 states of the Union. If a state forces abortion underground, that state will unfairly shift its own social burden to neighboring territories, to unaccountable practitioners, or else to emergency rooms, morgues, and crematoriums filled with stillbirths and mothers dead from complications or botched attempts to terminate pregnancies.
Stephen, can I get you to finish up, please, sir?
Yes, sir. In Planned Parenthood of Southeastern Pennsylvania, v. Casey, 1992, United States Supreme Court Justices O'Connor, Kennedy, and Souter determined that an undue burden exists and therefore a provision of law is invalid if its purpose or effect is to place substantial obstacles in the path of a woman seeking an abortion before the fetus attains life. Yes, sir. I'm done.
Thank you.
Just wanted to finish the quote. Thank
no,
you.
Thank you. I appreciate it. Any questions?
Thank you for your time. Any questions?
No.
Okay, thanks.
I'm patient, but not that patient. So. Chair will now call Laura Allen, representing herself, testifying against the bill. I'll be nicer to you.
Good evening, committee men and women. My name is Laura Allen, and I'm a constituent of Jimmy Don Acox. Since Roe v. Wade, we've had a constitutionally protected right to abortion. They've been performed safely for over 40 years, which is why I'm having trouble understanding the necessity of these additional burdens on health clinics.
I don't mean to interrupt you real quick, but
could you
tell me your position on the bill, please?
Oh, I'm sorry. My position is I'm against.
Yes,
I'm against the bill.
Thank you.
It seems to be an effort to make it more difficult to practice a constitutionally protected procedure. Personally, my college-educated sister, she married what we thought was a nice man who turned out to drink too much and beat her and cut up her clothes and hold a knife to her throat until he passed out. We were finally able to extricate her from that situation. We took her out of state, got emergency restraining order. It's not easy. She took on all the debt. She found out she was pregnant shortly after she left. She had all the debt. Had she had that baby, she would have had to be in contact with this man who had terrorized her. And I have no doubt in my mind that there's a good chance neither her nor the baby would be alive had she had that baby. She safely had an abortion. She is a successful married to a wonderful man with a beautiful child down. She's at the top of her profession. I thank God every day for my sister and for her right to know and understand what was right for her. You need to trust women to understand their choices in life. And government doesn't need to be big brother in this decision. So I just would ask you to trust us, women. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Allen. Is there any questions? Thank you for being here tonight. Appreciate it. Chair will now call Lisa Arnage, representing her Arnage. I hope I didn't screw that up totally. Sorry. Representing herself, testifying against the bill. Is Lisa here? We'll show her not testifying but against the bill.